All right, y'all, let's get going. Okay, so like I said, tonight we're going to talk about some of the practical applications and issues associated with space engineering. And here's what we're going to talk about kind of in order, roughly. There's two categories of topics here. One, the first category is things that you can individually control when you're thinking about building out your space system. And the second are things that you absolutely cannot control but probably should consider as you move forward with your space system. So let's talk about the easy stuff first. This is the individually controllable stuff. These are the engineering issues associated with your particular system. We're gonna talk about material outgassing first. Does anybody know what this is? Yes, all the Sputnik people know what material outgassing is. I talk about it a lot.
Probably a little too much.
Yeah. So I'm going to broadly, like tonight, we're not going to dive too much down into numbers. We're going to talk more on the surface level. So if you have further questions about the actual math behind a lot of this, we can talk about that further. But on a broad scale, think about it like this. So when you boil water at sea level, it boils at 100 degrees centigrade. If you go up to Mount Everest, the top of Mount Everest, water boils at a much, much lower temperature. Why? The partial pressure of that material goes way down, so all of the energy trapped within can basically leave that material much easier. And when you're talking about the vacuum of space, that is a much, 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 much harder vacuum. And so what ends up happening is that materials degas. Even materials that you think aren't gaseous, like metals, certain types of metals, certain plastics, end up becoming brittle, degassing, failing. You probably know outgassing best in the context of a new car. When you step into a new car, it has that like wonderful, awful odor that everybody loves to hate. And that is all the materials that are in that car outgassing in the worst way possible. Things like benzenes and bromated preservatives and all the above are being let go by those materials as they kind of age in the sun and in the heat. Happens in space to a much harder degree. So ASTM has set up a standard called E595 that governs or tests rather how materials behave in space. And E595 covers three key variables. The first is TML, which is total mass loss. So super simple, mass at the beginning of the test, mass at the end of the test. CVCM, which is basically the amount of collected volatile condensate material is left behind, expressed as a percentage of the original mass of the object. And then water vapor regain, which is the amount of mass that the material regains after it sat out on a bench for 24 hours at STP. So what does the test entail? Basically, the test entails bringing an object down to the hardest vacuum we can possibly generate or nearabouts here on Earth in a vacuum chamber and leaving it there for a defined period of time. And then all these measurements are taken before, after, and then 24 hours after. So there's a couple ways to get around this problem. It's a pretty serious one. There have been a number of failures of satellites and other space systems that have been attributed to outgassing. One of the most popular is PI. So this is the wise words of Rick Fleeter. He didn't particularly love the fact that I included this in the presentation, but it is true. He did say it in an email, and it is true in the sense that it would render Huevos Rancheros there. So what is PI? PI is basically encapsulating a thing within a resin. Outgas safe resin, so it's totally sealed off from the outside world. And a lot of satellites take this attitude, or a lot of space systems take this attitude when they're designing out their systems. So what happens in outgassing? Well, there's a lot of things that can happen in outgassing. Why this is a problem is optically, all of that material that's being evacuated from whatever the gas from your solar cell you didn't properly configure, from plastic housing you didn't properly configure or select the right material for, all of that can occlude optics. So any cameras you have up there, any lenses will just go foggy, no more. Electronics can fail because shorts can be developed, and deployables, which means like boom arms or drag devices or things like that will also potentially fail just because the materials themselves will fail. I think it's also really easy to think about this as a problem that's just for you in your system, but it's actually really not. A lot of the systems that are now going up, including all the ones that you're potentially designing, all the ones that are being worked on now, are sent up as part of a group of objects on a rocket. So you're not alone. And if you're outgassing, you're also outgassing onto your neighbor, which means that your satellite fails, so does your neighbor's satellite. So it's not just a you problem anymore. It's a everybody problem. So how do we deal with this? So you pot everything possible and you use outgas safe materials. There's a whole huge list of them. If you search on Google, NASA put together a database which has some 8,500 entries or something like that of outgas safe materials and their manufacturers, along with all of their test data. ESA, the European Space Agency, also put together a similar list. It's huge and really useful. It's also public data. Yeah.
Is potting like a big chunk of resin or like a coating of resin?
So you could do a lot of calculating. So I'll give you an example for Sputnik, the satellite we're working on. Our core is entirely Energizer AA batteries. And we're committing to putting about 2-3 millimeters of potting around the outside of every surface that would be exposed to gas. So really you're just preventing the material from evacuating into space. You're providing a barrier. There are like switches and things like that, like electronic components that just use a Kapton. Kapton is a plastic polyimide. It's a Kapton is a polyimide that is outgas safe, and some electronics just wrap Kapton tape around the outgas sensitive parts and call it a day. That's fine. Another question in the back. Shoot.
I was just asking about how much if the like potting material, how much that's like interaction. Has there been any problems with that interaction with the material that needs to be like potted?
Yeah, so potting resins and epoxies are usually electrically non-conductive. They're specifically meant for electronics. That's where they kind of started. You do have to be careful when you're designing your thing. Again, going back to Sputnik, the resin that we're using to pot is not electrically conductive, but it is thermally conductive. And it was selected for specifically that reason. There's thousands of resins you could pick from, and you just need to select the right one accordingly. We're taking a moderately severe approach when it comes to protecting our electronics from the resin. We have a couple connectors on board that we're sealing off from the resin before we pour. We actually poured last night at 3 a.m. So we'll see if it actually worked out today. So
before 3 a.m.
Well, we poured before 3 a.m. We were done at 3 a.m. Yeah. So there's also a thermal issue when you're talking about things in space. Here on Earth, we have the luxury of an atmosphere, which both helps to insulate us and also carries away thermal energy from us, from our electronics, from everything we're using and working with. Space does not have that. And there's also usually, at least when we're talking about satellites that are in Earth orbit, there's a huge nuclear reactor up there blasting like a shitload of energy onto the object in question constantly. It's the sun. So if you just took away all the light energy, you took away all the energy developing sources, the ambient temperature of deep space is basically 0 Kelvin. It's like nothing. Anything you're seeing, any temperature left behind is residual from the Big Bang. Obviously, when you're much closer to a sun or to Earth-like planet that's reflecting energy, you're picking up more of it as well. So these are things you need to consider when you're building out your system. And to give you a real-life example, you may have all heard of the James Webb Telescope. That's floating way up at L2, Lagrange point 2, and there's a sun shield on the James Webb, which just unfolded. It's multiple layers of Kapton, actually. And it's only there to protect the super sensitive electronic components from the radiation of the sun and from the heat of the sun. So a couple of key terms to know when you're talking about thermal energy, emissivity and absorptivity. It's the emittance and absorption of thermal radiation of a given material. Solar flux is the power per unit area generated by the thermonuclear bomb in the sky. And systems toolkit. So systems toolkit is not a term necessarily, but it is a program. And you can screw around with it for free as students. Systems toolkit is a modeling program that is good for thermal stuff and a lot of other things too. Not so good for a lot of things as well. But basically it allows you to model orbits and solar flux and things like that very easily. You might want to do that if you're thinking about how you're going to build out your satellite or system, especially if it's going to live in space for a really long period of time. So this is not necessarily directly related to the issue of solar gain, but I think it's important to remember that the thermal issue is actually a materials issue. That's how it's always solved. It doesn't have to be a materials issue, but it's always usually solved with material properties. And what you're seeing here, well, I won't spoil it.
But what we do have is we have the raw 9-pound material that we use. Now, these have been in there at 2,200 degrees for hours. So you'll see they're blazing, blazing hot. Now, most things, if you put in an oven, like if you put a frozen pizza in, it would disintegrate after a couple minutes. Well, these things have been in there hours. If you put in metal, if the metal did not melt, at least it would conduct the heat and keep the heat for so long that you couldn't get near it, well, you know, within hours. Well, look at that. I mean, you can take this off. It dissipates the heat so quickly that you can actually pick these up while they're glowing, molten in the middle.
How hot are they?
No, they were in the oven at 2,200 degrees.
Wow.
So you can go ahead. You can pick them up and take a picture. Just make sure you don't pick it up on the edges, just at the corners, just at the.
Oh, hilarious. Don't pick up the 2,200 degree Fahrenheit brick on the edges. But that material that you just saw right there is the same material that was on the space shuttle. It's the insulating tile on the space shuttle. It has a technical name. It's basically a composite of silica, gas, and ceramic. It's a pretty impressive material. So how do you deal with this in a practical term? So you can actively cool your satellite, just like a car. You can put a radiator on there and try and figure out a way to radiate that energy off into space. It's a very massy thing to do. It's not necessarily the easiest thing to do if you're talking about a small system like a CubeSat. You can use passive protection, like a coating, or like the James Webb with its sun shield. That's a passive system once it's deployed. So you can limit the number of highly absorptive materials on the satellite, meaning that the satellite just naturally wants to reflect away more of the thermal energy. And then importantly, it's good to do a lot of thermal testing and validation before you send this thing up into space. And this kind of goes into what I will talk about in a bit, but you don't get a second chance when you're making something in space. The first big space repair had been done a couple times before, but the first one that at least I can remember in my mind is Hubble. It was repaired 20 years ago. And that happens like never. And Hubble is like the biggest, prior to the James Webb, most important science instrument ever put up in space by humankind, short of like the space station and the Apollo missions. So kind of a high bar to get up there to justify repair. So this is one you should be familiar with already. If you haven't started to consider it, you definitely should. This is mass constraints. It's hard to get things up into orbit. It's expensive. There's a cost per kilogram, and there's a limit. You can only put so much up. In general, you want to make things as light as possible, but there's also a penalty associated with making things light, and that you're trading off mass for strength in a lot of cases. So this worker here is a worker at ULA, United Launch Alliance, which is a SpaceX competitor and another NASA contractor, signing his name on the back of a mating module for the Vulcan rocket, which is yet to fly. And what he's signing specifically is something called an isogrid. And it's a material, it's an aluminum panel that's been specifically milled and lightened so that it retains its strength. That ribbing that you see is what actually carries the load of the panel and allows the panel to perform at a much higher mechanical load than it would if it were just that thin all the way through. Safety factor is what I was talking about in a minute. So a safety factor is a multiple of max anticipated load condition. This is relevant for mass because safety factor invariably means that you're adding more material. Increasing safety factor means that you're adding more material to your system. So a car has a lot of safety factor. There's in fact a lot of safety systems built into the car. If you crash, you have an airbag, there's crumple zones. The car itself is designed to deform in a certain way so as not to like penetrate the compartment. The engine won't come flying in your face. And rockets don't have that. So if you look at the safety factor of something like a water boiler, something in your house, it's basically got a safety factor of 3.5 to 6, somewhere in there. Basically meaning that if the designer of that system anticipated that there was going to be a pressure of 100 PSI inside the tank, it's actually designed to hold at minimum 350 PSI safety factor. Rockets, aerospace parts, have a safety factor of just over 1, which means that there's no real room for extra load outside of whatever the anticipated load was. Now, this may seem to you like these parts are weak. They're not. What this means is that they're light, these parts are light, and that also the operating conditions of the system, the rocket, whatever, are really well spent. Safety factor is called safety factor because it allows engineers to cut corners. If you have a high safety factor, you can kind of like, you know, judge things. You know, you can say like, oh, safety factor 3.5, that sounds about right. You know, like the wall thickness can be, yeah, let's call it 1/8 inch. That's fine. In aerospace, there's no room for that. You have to know exactly what your loads are and design accordingly. And that allows you to design to a safety factor that's much tighter than a consumer product. This is just like, I love ISOGrid. I think ISOGrid is like the coolest thing in the world. This is the inside of the Dragon capsule, which sends up the astronauts, minus all of its beautiful white plastic cladding. So this is what you'd see if you just ripped out all the plastic shit on the inside that you see on TV, which is cool. And then here's another picture from ULA. This is the inside of one of the boosters. So when you see a booster flying up into space on the, or you see a rocket flying up into space, that tall column is exactly what you're looking at right here, except you're looking at the inside bits. Now, lightweighting and safety factor and material analysis also factor into consumer products. This is a brake caliper on admittedly a very high-end car from the Bugatti Chiron, which is, as a production, not anymore, but as a production, was the fastest consumer car in the world. And one way that they got there was by putting a ton of horsepower into an otherwise relatively light chassis. And they did so by lightweighting as many parts as they could, including these brake calipers, which is the part of the brake that kind of squeezes the rotor, which prevents the wheel from rotating further. And they drilled out or printed out, these are actually printed in metal, as much of the material as possible, so as to make them as light as possible.
They still put their name on it.
And they still put their name on it, that's true. It's a very impressive piece of engineering with their name on it. All right. So this next bit is SEU, single event upsets and bit flips. There are many types of failures in space associated with radiation and associated with computer error. SEU bit flips is just one of them. It's the one that gets talked about a lot. It's not the only one. You could go down a whole path of reliability engineering, space engineering, just understanding radiation, space radiation, et cetera. So an SEU occurs when a charged particle, like a cosmic ray, passes through an electrically sensitive component on a satellite. And basically, what it does is adds more charge or subtracts charge from that circuit. That's all it does. That's it. Now, this is important in the case of sensitive electronic components because the state of charge basically is what governs the compute of that system. So if you change the state of charge, you change the compute. And if you change the compute, you change the data. And if you change the data, you fall out of orbit. So what happens? How do you change that? How do you protect against it? Well, that's a hard question.
Hi, post-lecture Marco here. You're about to watch a clip of me saying that everybody on the Qantas Flight 72 died, and that's 100% untrue. In fact, the flight ended up making an emergency landing in Western Australia. It was on its way from Singapore to Perth, Australia, as on October 7th of 2008. There were a bunch of passenger injuries caused by unanticipated pitchdown maneuvers, but the flight was okay. Still a product of an SEU, but not quite as bad as it was originally made out to be in the lecture. My apologies.
Before we get there, I want to talk about one real life example. There's a Qantas airline flight 72 that crashed. Nobody could explain why it crashed. There was extensive research done. Like, and when I say extensive, I mean everything from terrorism to pilot error to mechanical strain to somebody put together a serious paper identifying alien sources as potentially being the cause of the crash. And ultimately, it seems like at this point in time, it was attributable to an SEU failing or an SEU occurring within the system that allowed for stability control. And that caused the plane to crash, killed everybody on board. This happens very infrequently. All these systems are designed to be redundant. You know, like safety critical systems are always redundant, but it does happen. It's not a non-zero problem. So up in space, we have these things called Van Allen belts. Van Allen belts are basically the magnetosphere of the Earth. To put it simply, I'm speaking in broad terms here. The magnetosphere of the Earth protecting all of the charged particles from hitting the Earth, and they accrue on the edges of these Van Allen belts. What you're seeing here is, video's not loading, that's all right. What you're seeing here, or what you would have seen here, is the fluctuation of the Van Allen belts over time. They are responsive to radiation coming off the sun, and they grow and shrink depending on season and depending on solar activity. So if you notice, there was kind of a toroidal shape to the Van Allen belts, and things in polar orbit, meaning things that go over each pole. So they wrote, if this is the Earth, North Pole, South Pole, polar orbit like this, things like that are exposed to much more radiation because they're just outside of or within the edge of Van Allen belt far more frequently than other satellites, which may rotate around the Earth like this, equatorially. So how do you deal with this? You buy radiation hardened memory and chips. These are super expensive. You can buy them on places if you're at all curious. You can buy them on a website called CubeSatShop.com. It's a really nice website for kind of pricing out space rated components. You can build redundant self-checking firmware, or you can put a shitload of shielding on your satellite. Shielding is often used, but again, there's a mass penalty associated with putting shielding on your website because invariably it's heavy. That's why it's good at being a shield. All right. So, yes.
What kind of materials is for shielding?
All kinds of materials. I know that's an unsatisfying answer. Things as widely variable as lead have been used. Same as here on Earth. Water happens to be a really good shield. So there's been designs for long-term space stations that involve basically storing tanks of water, circular tanks of water around astronaut compartments so that they're exposed to as little radiation as possible for the length of their mission. Anything dense has been used and proposed, and there's a lot of research going into lighter weight materials that also act as good shields. Shoot.
Do any satellites generate their own magnetic fields, or is that just like way too complicated and would interfere with the internal electronics?
Everything generates its own magnetic field.
To a substantial enough degree that it could be used to shield from charged radiation?
That's a really good question. To the best of my knowledge, I don't believe so, but also the energy involved in like gamma rays coming off the sun is crazy high. So you'd have to be basically, I mean, it's physics, you know, you have to counter the gamma ray with an equivalently energetic particle in order to shield something. Shoot.
What does it mean for some electronic components to be radiation hardened? How would you do that?
Yeah, so if you look, CubeSatShop again is a great place to look. A lot of these companies are very secretive about how they handle their own radiation hardening. Radiation hardening doesn't necessarily mean that there's physical shielding in place, although it could be the case. It may be that there's redundant firmware built into the system. It may be that there's seven sets of chips, so they consistently error check one another against one another to see if there's been any bit flips or errors. There are a lot of ways to kind of handle that, but generally it's either shielding or self-replication. Yeah, so there's ways to handle it that you could replicate. Like, so for Sputnik, for example, we're flying an Arduino, and on that Arduino, there's a watchdog timer. and three copies of the program that consistently self-check and self-reset. So we've achieved radiation hardening to some degree by doing such a thing. Yep. Okay, so vacuum welding. So this is a quote from the all hailed Richard Feynman in Feynman Lectures 12.2 on friction. And Richard Feynman was talking about why things vacuum weld together. Vacuum welding is essentially what occurs when there's no atmosphere, zero atmosphere, so a vacuum, between two objects of similar material construction or identical material construction. And what happens is, as he personified it, the two materials no longer know that they're separate. And so they just become one. This happens fairly frequently and actually can happen here on Earth. It's something you can look up on YouTube, but one of the like kind of gold standard tests for machinists is if they can make two blocks of metal vacuum weld together. And they do that by machining two blocks of metal as absolutely smooth as they possibly can. And then they just go like this, they shear them against one another, and if they stick, they've passed. Super simple. It's a really elegant test. So, has this,
Question. Is that like sonic welding?
No, so sonic welding actually imparts heat because there's ultrasonic vibration. There's a melting of the boundary layer between the two parts. It's on a very, very small level, but it is there. This is just the two materials, as Feynman says, essentially not recognizing where they begin and where they end. So this has happened in space. Galileo was sent up and was looking around at Jupiter. Once it got to Jupiter, its arms, its booms failed to deploy, and this beautiful kind of umbrella-looking device actually kind of stuck like this instead of wide open. What ended up happening was that NASA lost about 30% of their available mission, and they had to rejigger Galileo on the fly, reprogram once it was in space. Thankfully, they programmed in that capability, but this was later attributed to vacuum welding failure in the arms of the umbrella of Galileo. Does that make sense? What happened there? Yeah, so the consequences are very real. I mean, Galileo was a $10 billion mission, and 30% of that $10 billion mission just never happened because they couldn't do it. So how do you do this? How do you solve for vacuum welding? Something you might want to consider in your system if you have deployables or moving parts. You need to regulate material adjacency, which means it's, if possible, a good idea to put two dissimilar metals next to one another. In the vacuum of space, where thermal constraints are really, really important, it's also important to consider that the materials will expand at different rates, which will make for mechanical stress on materials. So you have to match those thermal properties against one another such that, or design around those thermal properties such that there's not a stress fracture or something that builds up over time. There are non-outgassing lubricants, which you can use to make deployables work more frequently or more often. Yeah, pretty straightforward. And then there are a bunch of coatings that help resist vacuum welding. Pretty simple stuff. Deployables themselves are not necessarily a problem, not like what I've presented before, but they are an issue in the sense that space engineers don't really like things that move in space because they represent risk for all of the reasons that I just talked about. If you can eliminate moving parts in your satellite, you have an inherently more reliable satellite or one that requires less overall engineering. So, what does that mean for you as a space engineer, a budding space engineer? You have a couple options for moving your objects forward through space. You design them super simply. You try and replicate functionality and software. And then importantly, you test to oblivion. And you should test to oblivion no matter what you're doing. That's just a good rule of thumb anyway. But deployables demand testing no matter what. Okay, so that's all the simple stuff. That's the stuff that you can control directly. Now let's talk about the harder stuff. This is the stuff that you necessarily can't control. and the things that may be institutional or issues of society. So first, let's talk about the reliability cascade. This is a term that I came up with. You don't have to use it. Please don't like go attributing it to me because I'm not fancy enough for that. But you can use it and talk about it like it's your term and I won't mind. So a space system is only as good as its weakest part. That's it. It's pretty simple. They have to work the first time. So let's do super simple math. Figure this out. So you have 10, 99% reliable elements. That's a super good bet, right? 10, 99% reliable elements. I would send that up all day. Except when they're combined into one unit, they then only become 90% reliable. So it's still an okay bet, not great. All right, so now let's say 10 of those subsystems are combined, which is totally reasonable. We're still within the realm of complexity for a moderately complex satellite. So if 10 of those 90% reliable subsystems are combined and they're dependent on one another, your system just became 34% reliable. That's a shit bet. That's terrible. What are you gonna do about that? Would you risk all of that effort? That's what happened with Galileo. There were a bunch of stacked systems that prevented Galileo from operating correctly. On the converse side, there are a bunch of systems that allow Galileo to recover after it failed. So there's ways around this problem. You can design kind of an octopi. Every tentacle has its own brain and can do its own thinking and operate independently of every other tentacle, every other subsystem. That's expensive and massive because you need redundancy. So there's advantages to that, but there's also disadvantages to that. Institutional conservatism. This is kind of unovercomable. If you're working within the confines of government systems and like NASA funding or ESA funding or something like that, you basically have very limited opportunity to go forward and do really cutting edge science unless it has immediate return and can be politically justified. So the budget of NASA is $23 billion. NASA fights for it every single year for their allocation. There's 16,000 employees that work for NASA in a full-time capacity. Anytime NASA fails one of its missions, that budget and those employees are in jeopardy. You can understand why NASA wouldn't want to do something totally off the wall. So if you look back through time, the other thing to consider is that NASA's budget, although $23 billion seems like a lot of money, is actually adjusted for inflation and a net decrease as compared to when Kennedy announced the moon missions in 1962 in Texas. So NASA, despite all of its best efforts, is still losing this battle, which is sad to think. The other thing to consider is that these missions take forever. And they span many, 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 many presidential administrations, many different types of ideologies, many different types of beliefs, which means that if science and engineering can be linked to political ideology in this gross metaphor for a minute, you have to consider that every single one of these objects that's listed here, these four objects, had to be palatable to every single administration that operated it or designed it or developed it. So how do you design a system that's not going to piss somebody off 30 years from now? That's kind of crazy. Would you go about, if you were a very liberal president, designing, for example, a system that, or encouraging NASA to design a system that proved evolution? Or if you were a very conservative president, would you go and design a system that somehow tested the primacy of the individual? Those types of things wouldn't necessarily be palatable. They get canceled when the next administration came along and didn't like that particular agenda. The International Contest of Science is exactly what you think it is. If we think back to like the heyday of the space race, why did Kennedy decide to put a person on the moon? Why didn't Kennedy make that announcement? Well, it wasn't because Kennedy was really into the moon. It's because Kennedy wanted to beat the Soviet Union. And this dictates a lot of the policy and engineering that goes into what happens in space. We're going to Mars now, supposedly. Why are we going to Mars? What's the actual science benefit of going to Mars? Cameron, you're shaking your head like you have no idea. I mean, to be fair, I don't either, but that's kind of, I mean, that's a good reason to do it in some ways. We don't know what's there. We should find out. But also, it's about demonstrating that we can. So let's see if we can get this to play. All right, we're gonna skip that because it's a very long speech and it didn't queue up to the right spot. I don't remember where it's supposed to be, but you can look it up yourself. It's a 1962 speech given in Texas at Baylor University. If you pay attention, you can notice Lyndon B. Johnson in the background, who eventually became president. Lyndon B. Johnson was kind of just like a notorious, I don't know, what's the right word? Not philanderer, but he was just kind of like a, just like a, like kind of a rascal asshole, I guess. And he's just in the background, like chumming around with his buddies and smoking a cigar. It's pretty hilarious. JFK is up on stage announcing one of the greatest things that America had ever done up to that point. And LBJ is back there like, yeah, what's up? Like, tell me, no big deal. All right, so space race is real. This is spending as a percentage of GDP. And you can see that, I mean, presidents talk about this all the time. Former President Trump, like, loved to talk about how China is winning. China's not winning yet in terms of the R&D spending, but they are coming close. And yeah, that's our main competitor at this point in time. And as evidenced by Tiangong, which is the Chinese space station, privately funded, built entirely by the Chinese government. China was frozen out of ISS. They weren't allowed to participate. There's never been a Chinese astronaut on the ISS. And so they went and did it themselves. All right, small and fast versus big and slow. This is true of all teams everywhere. You can either go really, really, really fast, potentially fail, and build kind of a small thing and scale up from there. Or you can spend $1 billion on making the perfect thing and then launch it, and it will be the greatest engineering work of all time. But there's a lot of risk associated with that too. Saturn V ultimately didn't really pan out to be what it was supposed to be. Same thing happened with the space shuttle. Space shuttle was supposed to be the end all be all that carried us to the Mars and to Mars and beyond, and it didn't end up working out like we thought it was. That was a huge program. There was a lot of risk associated with that. All right, so that's the end of the technical bit. And then I have one more bit on the metaphysics of prototyping, which I think will be useful to you guys as you start making things. But now's a good time to pause and ask if you have any questions. Questions? Concerns? Yes, shoot.
This might be a little far-fetched, but do you think space fund NASA funding will increase possibly military use?
NASA is a scientific organization first and foremost, and the U.S. under President Trump incorporated the Space Force for that purpose. So I think the Space Force will increase their funding, but NASA has never really directly engaged with defense, although they employ defense contractors for the building of rockets, and obviously you can build a rocket, you can build a missile, same difference. But yeah, I hope that NASA remains a scientific operation.
So is the Space Force in charge of space weaponry?
Space Force at this point in time is in charge of developing a codified defense and offense plan for space, building missiles, tracking objects in space, and keeping an eye on what our adversaries, America's adversaries, are doing elsewhere in the world. Our meaning, like, I care. Like, no,
we don't care. Organization that does stuff, like, I thought it was like kind of a joke.
Yeah, it is a real organization. They're an offshoot of the Air Force, or they were. They took over a bunch of bases. They have, I think, about 5,000 employees, which used to be, and like, you know, civilian and military folk. that used to be Air Force, but they've taken them, like, we're launching Sputnik come June 1st, and we're launching from Vandenberg Space Force Base. It's a real thing. If you go to the Space Force recruiting website, it's like the best website I've ever seen in my life. It, like, I have no interest in joining the military whatsoever. And it, like, made me want to join the Space Force. It was that good. I was like, shit, I can be a part of the future. Like, I need to go here. Yeah? Cool. All right. So this next bit is not so much to do with space engineering, more to do with a different way of looking at your problem set moving forward. When I say your problem set, I mean the PDR and your system design. I think here at Brown, there's a lot of focus on calculation and a lot of focus on thinking through a problem, which is totally valid and really important, but there's not as much focus on the making of stuff. So I don't know if you guys remember this, but this was the slide I showed during the first couple days of class. This is what I did professionally before I came to Brown for about 10 years. I did consumer product development, engineering, industrial design, things like that. And I'm sharing this with you now again to demonstrate that, like, my particular flavor of engineering is one where things are made and tested and fabricated in real life. It doesn't mean that it's good or bad, it's just mine. And I thought it was important to talk about my flavor because you guys are in the process of and have to deliver a real thing at the end of this course. I'm going to contrast myself against Rick, not because I'm on the same level as Rick, which I'm very much not, but Rick thinks about engineering in a very different way than I do. Rick is a back of the napkin calculation kind of guy. He's a thermodynamicist. So he has an equation and a number answer for basically everything. I am consistently blown away by that. I have no capability in that area, none. I build things, I'm very good at building things, and then I test them. That's what I do. So I'm gonna talk about that. So this is one of the last products that I actually worked on. Soup to nuts, this is actually my product entirely. Before I left industry and came to Brown, this is called the Fishbone. It's a little adapter which prevents 3.5 millimeter pins from breaking off inside computers when kids who are excited about learning stand up too fast in the computer lab. Solves a $75 repair problem, takes away a lot of the downtime. Seems like a super simple thing, but it just acts as a flexible breakaway connector so that the headphones pull out cleanly. How did I go about making this? So I could have done all the calculations, could have paid attention to material properties, but instead the process was go into a classroom, see what's happening with the kids, and then try and make something. And making involved in this case, taking the object that I had in my mind, drawing it out, sketching it out, making really low fidelity prototypes in paper, cardboard, wood, things like that, stepping up their fidelity. And this is kind of a middle ground prototype where I 3D printed a mold and injected silicone into the mold to test the flexibility of this particular product. In this particular instance, I was checking the ribbing that you can kind of see in the middle bit of the fishbone to see what the ideal spacing on the ribbing was and what the ideal material was of this product. I'm a little bit shy about showing this because another part of the reason why I left industry was because my environmental footprint was gigantic. I was making a lot of plastic parts, which didn't need to get made. But this product, as of 2015, had been sold in excess of 500,000 times by one company, and is still in production to date. And the best of my knowledge, in the 4 years since 2018, this has had a 3x year-over-year growth. So this is sold millions and millions of times every year now. And I'm not saying that because, like, I'm really good at product design. I obviously worked with people on this problem. This is a product of all of us working together. I'm telling you this because I used a very simple process to get to an end state. And it didn't involve a bunch of, like, high-end computer calculations. It didn't involve me going to, like, a machine shop and figuring out how to make things with machinists and tooling. I just did it. And it worked. I mean, it took a long time to get there. There are a lot of steps to the prototype, but it ended up working. All right, so again, broad strokes, I'm painting with a broad brush, right? But here's where I think Brown University falls, and it's what you guys are experiencing and are exposed to as undergrads, grad students. It's kind of like the methodology. You walk in to class, and the immediate answer is, what's the equation? How can we test this? Now, you are building things, like of course you are, but there's another way to go about this too. You know, you could be more like a biomedical engineer, you could be empirical in your analysis, but lean more towards testing by fabrication, or where I fall is far more towards the art sculpt side, which is intuitive engineering that tests by fabrication. What this means is that I have intuitions about the way things work. Of course I use math, of course I use all these calculations to help me, but at the end of the day, rather than relying on those calculations, I build a thing and I test that thing. Inherent to this idea is the notion that you yourself, you are the perfect sensor. You have the ability to perceive the world around you, unless you're working on like incredible radiation devices, whatever, you're working at the absolute upper end or lower end of human perception. You have a phenomenal ability to test weights, to sense light, to hear sound, to smell. All those things contribute to your understanding of the world and are valuable when you're engineering devices. If it feels like it's gonna work, it's probably gonna work. The SR-71 is one of the finest airplanes ever made, in my opinion. It's a huge black hulk that no longer flies, unfortunately. It's one of the fastest ever made. I think it topped out at like Mach 4, somewhere in there, 4 times the speed of sound. Crazy, crazy fast. And all of the engineering for that was done on paper before computers existed. And a lot of what the engineer said was that if it looked good, it was going to fly well. And it does. It's like incredibly sexy. It's like a beautiful airplane. And it flies pretty well. So there are a couple of rules for prototyping when you're building out using kind of the intuitive engineering model that I'm suggesting that you could try. And I want to be clear again, to reiterate, there's nothing wrong with any other way of going about the problem. This is just the way I go about the problem. I find it useful, so maybe you will too, right? You could be like Rick, that's totally cool. You could also be like anybody else. You need to find you, but this is the way I do it. So rules for prototyping, chunk the problem, and test your solutions. Define the tests really narrowly. Chunk the problem down into component parts. Isolate the variables. This is basic scientific method, but it's a little bit more difficult to do when you're talking about building a thing. So how do you build an object that tests for one variable? That's the question you have to answer here. Use the cheapest and fastest means available to answer your question as quickly as you possibly can. So if you can get an answer by cutting a piece of cardboard and testing fit, you should do that. There's no sense in making a part that hooks onto another part, designing it in CAD, printing it, just make it out of cardboard. That's okay. It doesn't mean that you need to use cheap parts. At a certain point, you have to use expensive parts. But at that point, when you reach that point of fidelity, the cheapest and fastest means of production will be milling it out of CNC and using CAD, doing all those super complicated processes. Do not get attached to the things you make. You are not your work. I know you feel like, and I feel the same way, like I think about this all the time. So do as I say, not as I do. The things you make are the things you make. They're separate from you. You can imbue them with meaning and love and care, and all those things are important. And you do that by thinking about them. You demonstrate your care by thinking about them. But if the thing fails, it doesn't mean you fail. And if the thing sucks, it doesn't mean you suck. It just means that you need to run another test. Trust your gut. That's the intuitive engineering part. You are the perfect sensor. And then importantly, when you're going through the exercise of prototyping, pay attention to yourself. Again, you're the perfect sensor. If you feel like something's off, something's off. If you feel like something is going well, it probably is. And if you have an intuition about how something could be better, you should follow that intuition. Okay, so to go back to the idea of prototyping, this is what I would consider to be a low medium fidelity prototyping. This is foam. This is insulation foam. You can buy this at Home Depot in 4x8 sheets. $10 for more foam than you'll probably use in 5 years. You carve this out using knives. You can use a hot wire. You could use a soldering iron. Super easy to find form and build something very cheaply and fast. So What does this mean in terms of process? In terms of process, it's important to think about process as a funnel. So at the beginning, where you are now, you try as many different things as possible, you build as many different prototypes as possible, you use the fastest, cheapest means of production, which is usually cardboard, just whatever, whatever you have on hand. You start to refine, get a little bit closer, you find more answers, you use more durable materials, takes a little bit longer, but at the end of the day, you know more and more until you finally, as Celia says, catch that drip, and you've arrived at a targeted solution, which may have been really expensive and slow to develop, but it's perfect. It solves the problem. So intuitive engineering, what I'm advocating for here, doesn't mean that you're absconding from calculation and math. Quite the opposite. It's important, but it's not the most important. It answers questions about functionality. It allows for easy redirects because there's not really that much investment in what you're doing. If you want to change something, you can change it very quickly. And importantly, this is, I think, the secret to all of this, is that it uncovers insight which you may not have anticipated happening in the first place. When you ask a question of math or you ask a question of a calculation, again, broadly speaking, you're going to wind up with a binary. It's either the number you thought or it's not. When you ask a question of a prototype, you're going to wind up with a whole qualified set of variables that you can then test and understand and try and build upon. That's what intuitive engineering excels at most. So ask me questions. That's all I got to say. Anybody got any questions? Yeah. Yeah, so I like prototyping when I'm asking questions of functionality. That fishbone example I showed you, I was testing material properties of different types of over-the-counter silicones. At that point in time, so I used that same mold and injected a bunch of different types of silicones of different durometers to understand which was the best given the conditions I was expecting for the product to live within. You can test questions of human interaction. In the context of space, you could test questions of operation, how things are working in the environment in which you anticipate them working. So like we're right now for Sputnik about to throw our satellite into a vacuum chamber. And we're throwing in kind of like a semi-finalized prototype, but we're fully prepared that this prototype, this kind of like super qualified prototype that we've developed, the data we get back may show that we need to change something. That's the kind of thing that's testable using a prototype. Yeah? Anything else?
Is intuitive engineering industry jerk, or is that one of your?
No, that's a Marcoism.
Oh, it's a great one.
Yeah, I think people undersell their own capability a lot of times, and I don't like talking about intuitive engineering so much in the context of a like major R1 institution, because it feels a little bit like, well, you can just kind of wing it. And I'm not advocating winging anything. What I'm advocating is following a systematized, rigorous process, but using a different set of inputs than you would before. Cool. All right. Well, that's it, guys. I think that's everything.